Good morning.
Good morning.
Merry Christmas to all of you. It's Christmas Eve. It's also National Eggnog Day, if you were into that. So, just letting you know about that.
Everybody is sold out.
Probably so. So, if any of you used to watch Seinfeld, yesterday was Festivus. So, you know, so. If you never watched Seinfeld, that's lost on you. So,
anyway. My back's still hurt.
Yeah. Do you have the airing of the grievances yet? Or?
That's what my
back's right. Oh, okay. So.
Is Festus's cousin?
No. It was Festivus for the rest of us, is what they call it.
Okay. I was yesterday.
No relation to Festus.
Right. So, but it was a secular holiday, you know, so anyway. All right. Well, it's good to see each of you here. And giving the choir off the next couple of weeks off. So you get to be the choir today and sing the call to worship with us. So go to 204 in the red hymnal, and we're going to sing Emmanuel together. So number 204. So.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And Merry Christmas Eve to everyone. I'm thankful that everyone is here today. Good to see your smiling faces and hope everyone is doing well. I'm going to do things a little bit different today. I guess it's a point of privilege. But I wanted to open reading the scripture for today. And I'm going to be reading the traditional Christmas Advent reading from Luke chapter 2. Everyone is very familiar with this. Starting in verse 1, it says, "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken in the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them at the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified, but the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger.' Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests.' When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about.' So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. If you would, let's bow our heads. Loving God, you demonstrated your love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I trust in your unfailing love. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Teach us to love you with all our hearts and with all our soul, with all our minds and with all our strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Teach us to love our enemies and do good to those who hate us as Jesus commands. Help us to remain in your love. Help us to do everything in love as we live in faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for us. Amen.
Well, we're going to sing some Christmas songs now. When we're done with that, Sherry and Pat are going to bring us some special music if Sherry agrees not to turn the microphone off. So. Yeah, don't. It's an inside joke. So anyway.
It's not funny anymore.
Yeah, it's not. So. All right, but let's go to 251 in the red hymnal, Go Tell It on the Mountain. We will sing all three verses. Hymn number 251. Go to 217 in the same hymnal, Away in a Manger, 217. We will sing all three. This time is going to be 219, just a couple pages over. What Child Is This? 219. We'll sing all three verses.
What Child Is This?
reason Stan said that's a joke, I mean, not turning the microphone off, is because he always reminds me, don't turn the microphone off. And what do? I turn it off. That's old age for you. But what better day to be in the house of the Lord than on Christmas Eve?
Amen.
We had such a great celebration with our family yesterday, and lots of food and lots of gifts. But this is the greatest gift of all. And without this gift, there would be no Christmas. It's A flat.
Again, good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everybody. You're looking so festive, and they're red and green. I even got a little more festive today. I brought a red bucket. So. So that's about as festive as I get, is bringing a red bucket. So. We have just a couple of announcements. The basic Bible study will have, let's call it an epiphany party, okay? Have that on the 27th at Jerry and Sherry's home, and see Elaine for details, and that's at 10 a.m., so come and be part of that. We will not have Bible study in the morning, on Sunday mornings here, obviously today nor next week, but in 2 weeks we'll start that back, the new study on January 7th. Online Bible study will meet Thursday the 28th, and if you need instructions, see Jerry as far as getting on for that. And let's see, first Sunday singing 2 weeks from today, so I don't know what the food theme's going to be, but I imagine it will work around anybody who wants to bring dumplings, you know, so that'll be so do we have any other announcements, anything we want to know about today? Okay.
Well, hello again, and I am wearing my manger scene tie. Looks very similar to what we have here on the altar with Joseph and Mary and Jesus. Mary Jean reminded me that I didn't wear my Santa Claus tie this year, and I said, well, maybe next week. But I tell you, it's a great season to be in. This year has been extremely meaningful to me. Starting from the 1st of December, it's taken on just a little bit of different meaning, I think. Another year older, and realize what's really important. Number one is my relationship with my Lord and Savior. I mean, that's at the top. Scripture tells us to love our Lord, our God, with all of our heart, soul, mind, body, and strength. I fall short of that every day, but I keep trying, and that's what's important. And folks, I want to tell you, I'm thankful for y'all. Thankful for my church family, all the double agents we have out there far and wide. It really is a blessing to me. And as we move into a time of prayer, I just want to remind everyone that Laura and her family are feeling under the weather. David Arrington, Terry's brother. Remember Mary Jean, she's still struggling. Got the Sarah Duke family. Several families are dealing with loss. The Zavala family, Scott Elliott, Stephanie and Scott Collins, that's Alex's dad and stepmother, as she deals with her recovery. And are there any others we need to lift up today?
My brother-in-law. Yes. My brother Flint Sutherland, my brother-in-law, sister's husband, went to hospital last night. He hopes, if all his tests work out pretty well, hopefully he'll be out this afternoon.
Leon.
He is on that list, as are you, and we are very thankful that he's had good progress so far. I got a picture of the nice fancy ramp you got, and I'm thinking you're going to enjoy that, and looks like they did a very nice job with that. We got all the other folks in our church that are needing prayer. You know, the Hammonds got a good report, but let's keep remembering them and talk to John Minton. He's back over at Oak Landing, stirring up trouble and. Right like he's used to doing, and I tell you, John's a unique fella, as you know.
His spirit is still sky high.
I tell you, he is Mr. Positive.
Absolutely.
I tell you what, he lifts me up every time I talk to him, and I'm thankful. John's been through a lot in the last year, and I tell you what, he loves this church and he loves y'all, and he talks about you every time I talk to him.
Like you said, he gets his stitches out Tuesday.
Yeah, and this week he does. Yes, so he's doing well. But let's remember them, and let's remember anyone who couldn't be here with us today as they struggle. Are there any others?
Hoyt Casey.
Okay. Bless. Any others? How about unspoken prayers? Thank you. I would just invite you to join me in a time of prayer. Sherry, play softly, and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer at the end. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, we come to you this morning, grateful hearts, blessed lives. Lord, I thank you for each person that's made their way out today in every church, not just in Alabama, the United States, but everyone who has already gone to church today to worship you, doing exactly what the angels told us to do. Lord, for each name that's been lifted up, especially the unspoken prayers, Lord, we give them all to you, and we humbly ask that your will be done. Lord, during this time of celebration, festivities, lights, gifts, and presents, Lord, help us to ponder like Mary did, down deep in our hearts, the true meaning of this season. That you sent your son here to be born in a manger, live on this earth, but ultimately to die for our sins. And Lord, for any way that we have failed you in the days past, Lord, we ask your forgiveness. Lord, hear us now as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I would invite you now to join me in affirming our faith as we recite the Apostles' Creed. It's found in number 881 in the red hymnal and printed in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For ushers, would you please come forward? Let's bow our heads. Almighty God, we thank you for all that you do for us. Lord, at this time, I ask you to bless these tithes and offerings that we're about to receive. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Once God's plan was a mystery, hidden from our sight. Now God has disclosed what was kept secret for so long. He has brought it out in the light. In the brighter light on this fourth Sunday in Advent, may we see more clearly the glory of God in Christ and sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth, I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Psalm 89:1-2. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. We light the first candle to remind us to keep awake and be ready. The second Advent candle reminds us to change our ways. The third Advent candle reminds us of the good news that the blind can see and the lame can walk. We light the fourth Advent candle to remind us that God is with us. Light, light four candles, see them glow brightly so that all may know how four candles show the way, making our darkness bright as God's day. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Let's pray. Dear God, your faithfulness has been great, leading us to this day of anticipation and celebration. May the glorious light of your steadfast love shine brightly in us and through us, that all may give you praise and glory. In the Savior's name we pray. Amen. To a people longing for hope and yearning for deliverance, the prophet Isaiah declared, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." Today on Christmas Eve, we come seeking hope, peace, joy, and love. And we find these things in a child. God made flesh as a baby in a manger, a baby who is both the beginning and the end of our salvation, who dwells with us even now, our Emmanuel, God with us. The middle candle we're not going to light, but it's called the Christ candle and represents the life of Christ. The color white is for purity because Christ is our sinless, pure Savior. We light these candles as signs of our shocking hope, our just peace, our fierce joy, the love that transforms us, and Jesus Christ, our wondrous light. May the light burning in our hearts guide us, comfort us, protect us, and tend us in all seasons and circumstances, reminding us that day and night, in the light and in the darkness, God is with us. Our salvation has come. Amen.
Thanks, Elaine and Martha. A couple of funny things. You know, I think it's okay to laugh in church. I hear a lot of laughter here. We have a lot of people with a great sense of humor. I just wonder if the Allen brothers have ever taken up the offering together before. First for everything. You know, I was kind of a little nervous about that. I wasn't sure exactly what. Yeah. And then last week, my hearing's not as good as it used to be, and I tend to overhear things off, and Sherry and Pat were talking about, as I found out, they were talking about music and the song she was going to sing, what I heard Sherry say, and Martha thought about you, she says, I heard Sherry say, I call him Roy. And you know she's saying, I call him Lord. So I said, Sherry, I said, Sherry, who do you call Roy? Because evidently Cindy's husband is now Larry. Yeah, he's changed his name to Larry from Gary. And so last week and today, I hear her saying, I call him Roy. That's what I hear her singing.
Yes, Roy named King.
Short for Roy, really?
Means three.
How about that?
He'll answer.
Yeah. And then the last little funny thing today, that lighter over there for the Advent candles, it's tricky. It doesn't have the thumb release. You just pull the trigger. And it's hard to pull. So I went over there and I said, I'm going to make sure this thing's working okay. So I looked at the Christ candle and I said, man, that wick is way down there. Normally it's right at the top, you know, brand new candle. So I light it and stick it down in there, and it's straight down, and it just won't light. It won't stay lit. So I pick up the candle and I stick it in there and finally get it to light. And all of a sudden it starts melting. It's a plastic candle. It's a battery operated candle. And the inside of it's all burnt, and I said, it's a good thing we don't have a fire alarm here, because I would have sent it. And man, it stunk. I think somebody pulled a joke on somebody there, and but I said, man, I'll tell you what, you know, it's okay to laugh in church. And
then you had a girl come in this morning from the wrong church.
Yeah. You know, it, look kind of like a younger version of Bonnie. Short, bright. She came in right behind you too, and I said, "Wow, how about that? I wonder." I figured somebody invited her, and so sadly she was at the wrong church. She was supposed to be across the street, but I did tell her. I said, "Well, once you come in, you can't leave." Oh me. Well, I tell you, today's a good day. Do you recall the scripture reading from Luke? And there's a small part of that scripture reading that I want to focus on today. There's a brief hymn in verse 14, a song that we all know in the red hymnal, number 238. Angels we have heard on high, Gloria in Excelsis Deo. This comes from the first words in the Latin Vulgate translation, meaning glory to God in the highest. I don't know how many syllables there is in Gloria in that song, but there's a bunch of them. The angel's declaration was a lesson for each one of us this Christmas Eve. It's a lesson that we should always and everywhere in all that we do recognize the majesty and the glory of God by giving praise to Him. We should praise God where He currently resides, on the throne in heaven, wherever that is. We should praise God as we rise in the morning, in the noontime, as we go about our daily lives, and in the evening, as we rest from our labors. And I think everyone would agree with me that even though many of us may be retired, the work never ends. I can tell you that Mary Jean works harder now than she ever did when she had a full-time job. The angels tell us that we should praise our Lord in the rainstorms. We should praise Him on the sun shining days. Pat, we should praise God when we're on the mountain. We should praise Him when we're in the valley. Somebody ought to write a song about that. We should praise Him while we're stuck in a miry pit. We should praise God in the highest heaven when we're recognized and exalted on this earth. Kind of like I am on Pastor Appreciation Day. As I've told you many times, that this year was a little not as over the top as it was last year. Two very, very humbling days for me. I didn't leave here with a big head or a puffed up ego. I left here about as humble as I can get. The second part, verse 14, is what I want us to really focus on today. I would say most every church reads it at some point in time, somewhere, every year. But do we, as servants, as followers of Jesus, allow the significance of what the angels had to say said into our minds and apply it to our lives? Verse 14 says, glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace to those on whom His favor rests. Many Bible scholars agree that peace is not guaranteed for everyone. Peace is available to those who are pleasing to God. Anyone experiencing peace in their lives are the recipient of God's good pleasure. There was a sense of peace in that day, pa Romani, The Roman peace in the time of Jesus mainly came from external factors due to the military strength of the Roman army. But what we read here today is a proclamation from the angels that was a much deeper and more lasting peace than anything that Rome could provide. It was a peace of mind and a peace in their souls, a peace that could only be made possible by a Messiah and a Savior. The peace with God that the angels were describing is a peace that can only be received and experienced by those having faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And this peace and favor on believers like us comes to those on whom his favor rests. This season of Advent is a time for us all to celebrate the birth of our Savior, but it's also a reminder for us to remember to praise God, to take stock in our faith in Jesus and ask ourselves this question: is Jesus the Lord of our lives every second of every minute of every hour of every day? It's real easy to live a Christian life in church. It's real easy to live that life when you hang around with other church folks. But I'm talking about 168 hours a week. I know there's a lot of times I think most all of us at some point, except for a couple of us, have been sick over the last month. And it's real easy in the struggles that we face in life to maybe even feel sorry for ourselves and forget what all God has done for us. But folks, I want to tell you, over the last month, I've had nothing but time. And everywhere I turn, around every corner, every place I go, every phone call I get, every text I get, is a reminder of what God has done for us. Mainly because I focus on what God has done for me. He sent Jesus to this earth to be born in a lowly manger so that he could live a little over 30 years to die on a cross. And it's a reminder to me that there wouldn't have been a cross if there hadn't been a manger. Even though we celebrate the lights and the trees and the presents and the family gatherings and the friendship and the love, and folks, I want to tell you, I wouldn't give anything for the love that I feel in my heart that I receive on a daily basis from each one of you and all the other related church family members. It's such an awesome experience to be your pastor and your shepherd. And during this sacred time that we remember the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, let's all remember to give God the glory for it all. Honor him, praise him through the good times and the bad, because he deserves it. And that's what he wants from us. I invite you to join me this Christmas time and reevaluate our relationship with God. Is it where it needs to be? If it's not, I recommend that you make it right. I'll be glad to talk with you about it. Or anyone who may be watching online, just give me a call, send me a message. And stand in the And the ladies come, if you would bow your heads. Almighty God, the day of joy returns, Father in heaven, and crowns another year with peace and goodwill. Help us rightly to remember the birth of Jesus, that we may share in the song of the angels, the gladness of the shepherds, and the worship of the wise men. Close the doors of hate and open the doors of love all over the world. Let kindness come from every gift and good desires with every greeting. Deliver us from evil by the blessing that Christ brings, and teach us to be merry with clean hearts. May the Christmas morning make us happy to be with our children, and the Christmas evening brings us to our bed with grateful thoughts, forgiving and forgiven. For Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn today is in the red hymnal, hymn number 230, 230. We will sing, O Little Town of Bethlehem. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. So please stand as we sing.
I just want to say a big thank you to Larry and Cindy for giving me this Christmas time. I've been in ministry for about 18 years, and I've never been able to find a Christian-themed tie that I could tie around my neck and come down and put it here where it's supposed to go. I've had a couple, and I barely get them tied, and the bottom's way up here. Where they found this big and tall Christmas tie, I'll never know, but I'm thankful for Gary and Cindy, and I wish they were here to see me wear it. Anybody got a word?
Beautiful service.
Bless you. Thank you.
Amen.
Bless you. Thank you so much for being here. I hope everyone has some place to go or family to be with tomorrow. If you're home alone, give me a call. I'll send Jerry over to spend. No, seriously. Yeah,
I'm glad to send him over.
Yeah. Bless y'all. Thank you so much. Let's bow our heads. Almighty God, we thank you for bringing us together today. We're thankful for your word that's here to teach us, enlighten us, and help us to grow. Lord, I ask you to go with us now as we go out into the mission field. Lord, help us to be examples for others. Lord, let them see your light in us. And Lord, help us to find someone to invite to church. And all God's people said,
Amen.
God bless you. Thank you.